mata de Puerto Rico. Esta bomba yo la dedico a toda mi gente de Puerto Rico, a la familia Fontané, allá en Cumbe Alto y lo Mejía en Vega Baja. ¡Que goce!
¡Bomba, bomba! ¡Para siempre!
¡Bomba, bomba! ¡Está presente! ¡Aquí lo canta mi gente!
¡Bomba, bomba! ¡Para siempre!
¡Baila, baila y goza! ¡Mi bomba puertorriqueña!
¡Bomba, bomba! ¡Bomba, bomba! ¡Bomba, bomba! ¡Bomba, bomba! ¡Bomba, bomba! ¡Para siempre!
Once again, UCSI University has made it to the top and is the best private university in Malaysia based on the QS World University Rankings 2020. Among the private universities in the country, we scored the top in 4 out of the 6 categories ranked. This attests to the continual international recognition given to our reputation and credentials. For twice in a row, UCSI has been ranked the top 6 university in Malaysia, top 2% in the world, and top 70 of all private universities under 50 in the world. Furthermore, for 2 years in a row, UCSI's Institute of Music has been ranked the top 100 in the world under the Performing Arts category. All these speak volumes about UCSI. We thank all our staff, students, and alumni from all our campuses for being part of us in this journey. With our increasing commitment to be among the best, we look at our achievement today and resolve to be even better for years to come.
Hello everyone, welcome to UCSI Live Forum. I'm Mary, your moderator today. And here with me, I have the good-looking gentleman on your screen right now, Assistant Professor Dr. Khairul Azril bin Ismail, Director and Acting Dean of Postgraduate and Research, the Institute of Arts and Design of the UCSI University. So, Dr. Khairul, how are you?
Doing good. Thank you so much for having me over here, Mary.
Sure. Right. So, Dr. Khairul, before we start to our topic, which is digital versus traditional arts, which one is better than the other, maybe I would like you to introduce a little bit about yourself.
Okay. Yes. Thank you, Mary. Well, today we're going to speak about traditional and digital art to see which one is the comparative study. But before that, let me just introduce myself. My name is Dr. Khairul Azril. I'm currently the director of the Institute of Creative Art and Design and also the acting head for the postgraduate studies over at UCSI, in which particularly we specialize in the area of art and certainly design, in which covers encompass within our 9 programs from diploma all the way to the postgraduate master's program. And in terms of my background, I'm an avid image maker, particularly in the photo historical processes, in which is part of the 19th century traditional image making process. And it's kind of like an interesting note right there, because right now we are, well, at the beginning of the 21st century, in which I am quite fortunate to live in the age where everything was analog, semi-digital, in between analog and digital, and now it's like a fully encompassed 100% or applied digital in almost everything.
Yeah. Mm. And I read on your profile also, you are a Nikon Shooting Star program mentor, starting from 2016 until today itself, correct?
Until present. I mentor image makers of today in terms of utilizing the Nikon cameras and digital imaging. Not only that, we do a lot of projects in between as well, in terms on image makers who have no experience of using the camera, and then now they are much more familiar in terms of using it, not merely of the technical but also the concept of behind making images as well. So that per se, and on the side as well, I do as well curatorial work for local and international galleries, because previously my portfolio as well encompassed of images that is from prison. So that's another set of story that is reserved for another day.
Mm. It must be interesting. Yeah. Anyway, I also read that you are trained at the Fox Talbot Museum.
Correct.
Would you like to share more about that?
Yes, it is, like I mentioned before, I do photo historical process, and my background is in photography.
Yeah.
And within that, because studying photography, it was about 20 over years ago, you look into a historical book, part of our curriculum or program, we have to study history. And one of the main component history in the history of photography is the daguerreotype. The daguerreotype is the first generation process in which utilizes silver and a bit of gold, and as well in terms of making image. So that got me curious as well, and I was wondering if processes in the past could be done as of today. Manuals were like, literally it was before internet was a thing, so I had to go to the library and search for journals, articles on how about making it. And of course, journals of the past is not an easy thing to decipher. So within that, I realized that things could be done. It uses the same principle of science. You use chemistries, the laws of physics still is the same thing like how it was hundreds of years ago. And the contraption, something like that needs to be built. That's where I learned carpentry and also metal smithing. So you are a bit of, you have to specialize in a bit of a whole lot of things just to emulate, not just to emulate, to repeat back us how they did in the past. So, yeah, that's where I got my training as well, over at the Fox Talbot Museum under the tutelage of right now Dr. Mike Robinson, who taught me that, and as well with Jerry Spagnoli. Both are grandmasters in this photo historical craft.
That's pretty interesting. So now I get to know more that, like, you know, why you are here to talk about the digital and traditional arts. You've been passing through everything. Okay, so Dr. K, I understand that the traditional arts is an artistic activities, like such as, like, based on my understanding, it's music, dance, and some crafts, which is passed down from generation to generation in the community. So I believe in each countries, and even in Malaysia, we do have the traditional arts that we carry on from generation to the generation. But what is actually the difference of this traditional art and the digital art?
Well, if we specify or narrow down towards visual art, because a traditional art can be a lot of things.
Yeah.
It can be music, it can be literature, it can even be as simple as cooking. Traditional dishes is an artistry on its own. So if we encompass on visual art per se, or the art of crafting, even by definition, let's work on the definition itself. Traditional art, what is it? If we, as we are in Malaysia, the word gambar GAMBAR, has been around for about 300 years. So that's even before photography. So in local, gamba means picture. But then I got down to do a bit of digging and research. The meaning of gamba is actually is a Malay word. It's a really old Malay word. But it is actually penuke, or craft making, craftsman. So it's more in closely, okay, in regards on the action of hands. So it's in imbued spirit of emulating what is being seen. So many people have been struggling to see and share it with others. They use whatever tools that they have. Of course, they use sculpturing abilities such as mud, clay, charred woods, sharp bones, animals, special sort of emulated pigments or from arriving from mineral. And of course, we know that they've been drawing as well with pencil and on papers, painting with paints, sculpting with clay, bones, and stones. The material world offers so much and a lot of possibilities to arrive to actually solidify and structure things of what they see and what they represent. Because it is the action of creating what they see and to experience it as well. I mean, like a visual, that's an interesting bit right here. It's older than language itself, specifically older than writing itself. I mean, like people in the cave, the first thing that they communicate is they draw. They don't write. The structure of language comes in a lot more later. The alphabets or something like that is something that is more structural form, and it has to be noted as a something of a universal application. But drawings onto the wall, drawings onto any sort of material surface, it's more of pictorial. Everybody can well understand the picture of a man, picture of a woman. Animals, plants, knowledge has been passed down. So that's where that got me interested a bit right there. When you say traditional and digital, both have different tools and different premise. But you would have to see us more towards imaginary, where memory comes into play. What you see, you have to remember, and you have to draw as well. So all in all, artists draw something that they saw in that particular moment. They have to imagine it because the visual elements come into play. So what appears dark, what appears light, they have to consider all that as a factor itself.
All right. So, yeah, basically, based on my understanding, that the traditional art that you're trying to explain is like the one, like, for example, maybe we can see in the TV that, like, you know, in some cave, they draw in the cave, and then that is how it is. But do you think that the traditional art is still important up to today?
It is important, but nonetheless, it changes as well. I mean, like the difference is traditional art is a small little actions that accumulates to an experiential knowledge, because traditional art has a certain originality elements inside it. If we talk about visual art, it's often to be considered worth in terms of value, and certainly it has its own imperfections. The art itself, or traditional art, carries the unique authenticity or quality of it. Of course, it's being made through equipments and materials, or worldly materials, as I mentioned it before. Whether or not, vice versa, whether if it's better or digital per se, it depends on the application itself.
All right. And a lot of people already, like, you know, mentioned that, like, you know, nowadays, because, like, the technologies is growing, and then a lot of people already using, like, visual art or digital art. A lot of people mentioned that, like, you know, nowadays traditional art is dying. What do you think about that opinions?
Well, traditional art, it's not commonly practiced, just like how it was like before. The school of thought right here is like, before this, everybody is able to draw. and they draw very, very well. I mean, like the era of Raphael, Michelangelo, not the Ninja Turtle sort of thing, but Raphael, Michelangelo, even like Leonardo da Vinci itself. In those days, most of the learned people or people who have knowledge of language are able to draw, are able to visualize it and actually apply it onto a piece of paper. Now, the interesting bit right there, it's just as important as it is to the knowledge of mathematics. Because it has a scientific application. People have to illustrate what they see in the world and to actually translate it onto paper and to actually to embed it as absolute knowledge. That's change. Technology has changed the mannerism of those action. Is it dying? Well, I believe it's a cycle of things. It transforms. Digital is there as a tool. I do agree that it has its significant advantages and importance because there is more exploration. It is more forgiving as well, financially and also knowledge-wise. It brings forward the new types of knowledge. But however, there is certain pros and cons towards it, in which we can see people still laugh nowadays, ha ha ha, I can't draw. Yeah. And then why not just ha ha ha, I can't do mathematics. Nobody says that. Nobody dares to say something like that. Because basically, the intrinsic value of drawing is just as important as it is on the component of somebody's able to count. Both are imaginary force. So, in which when digital arrived, now that's an interesting bit right there. The affordability is there. But the materiality, the resources, needs to be contained in somewhat. With art, well, like I say, once you run out of your pencil, your colored pencil, you have to go out, run and buy it. But with digital, per se, you have to charge. That's it. I mean, like, I'm out of battery, so I got to charge it back again to continue on doing the work. So both have its own proponent of learning. Whether or not if it's applied as being easier than tradition, yeah, I would suppose so. Traditional, you have to learn through mistakes. Because doing mistakes are your, your main teacher. And errors and per se, and then you improve through experience. And you improve slower than digital. With digital, and now we've combined as well with the era of the internet, you have a lot of opinions, a lot of inspiration, aspiration to work with. Traditionally, I grew up with magazines, newspapers. I don't know if you guys have pen pals. Well, nowadays you guys have followers, Twitters, Instagram, shared knowledge almost instantaneous. Last time I got to wait months for any reply from my pen pals. And then as well, last time I used to be able to, not used to, I still am able to write cursive writing. So those kind of like squiggly writings and so forth, I'm still able to apply that. And I still write letters and postcards.
Wow.
to my friends abroad. And they still receive it in good hands. And it becomes as an intrinsic value between ourselves. So back to the idea whether the traditional art, is it dying? Maybe it's a cycle. It will resurface back again. It becomes as an interest to those who wants to know more. You have the eager mind and then you have the eager followers. That's why we keep on seeing people who's able to draw wonderfully, produce things beautifully. You have legions of followers. Maybe it just doesn't transmit the same way. In the past, you got to go to the guru and learn. Now you just have to follow. So you have a certain leaps and bounds. There's a mix of things. People will learn how to draw. They still do that, but in a different pace or a different mannerism.
I always enjoy to see any pictures and anything related with the arts, but unfortunately I don't think I'm really, really good. As you say, some people will say they cannot draw. I'm not sure if I can draw. I can draw like simple house for sure, because when I was young, I used to draw that. And okay, back to the our topic, the digital art itself.
Okay.
I read that the digital art, it's actually not a thing that, like, you know, only hit recently, because a lot of people maybe thought that, like, you know, digital art is like a recent thing just because of the technology. But based on what I read, it's actually since 1970s, various names have been used to describe the process of this digital art, like computer art, multimedia art, or new media. New term is like a media art. They call it media art. Mm-hmm. Okay. So based on this digital arts, is actually what are the tools that normally an artist use to make the digital art itself?
Okay. Historically, if we are to speak about since 1960s, people have been exploring this computer art, the use of electronic to produce. And computer during that time was a really specialized tool. I mean, something that that is really the most powerful system is as big as a building. So the only institutions that can afford it is like universities and big companies. So there, artists have yet to explore it as yet during that particular point in time. But you have engineers and the creative engineers start to like muddle around with it. But in 1970s, in which you have people like Mr. Sasson, I think Steve Sasson, he's a 20-year-old engineer who went into George Eastman house and worked there. And I still do have an email exchange with Mr. Sasson, like about 10, 15 years ago. And to speak, to just out of curiosity, what kind of things that he had created over there. One most important component out of many that they had created was a digital camera. This particular digital camera is an interesting bit right there. It's very big. It's how big? It's about a meter long by half a meter long and a meter high. So it's like a big furniture in which it records image on a cassette tape. I don't know if you have the experience using cassette tape, but it's a magnetic tape in which records information, and it records and play on a charge coupling device. Nowadays, we call it as a CCD, which probably some of the image maker or photographers who are familiar, that is a microchip that's applied inside the camera itself. So when it's being created in 1970s, Kodak or George Eastman House, still keep it as a secretive. But however, as technology evolves, things get smaller and smaller and smaller. It's being applied onto various technologies during in 1980s. It is when in 1980s where artists and engineers start to combine, actually do something with digital image making. It's not the most perfect sort of tool, but it is an experimental per se. And with that, the interesting bit right there is like you have a name artist such as Damien Hirst in the UK, combined with various engineers. They always do a lot of collaborative projects and arrive to what we call it as multiple media, means utilizing a lot of media to relay image on within objects. In photography, we always call it as image object. You mean like this piece of paper right here. You have, we call it as a, not image, but it's an object that is on the paper. Okay, so with that image object, it can be translated in any medium, on the screen, monitors. You have like experimental artists such as Nam June Paik, who have various TVs installed since 1970s, if I'm not mistaken, and have it as a sculptural installation. So you have experimental artists who break away the traditional painting, flat 2D, just like you see right behind me, and it becomes as a dimensional thing, as a sort of interactivity. And it goes on as well, even in the year 2000, in which I was fortunate to experience it myself, in which the internet starts to take shape. It starts to interact with us. During that time, internet to me was like purely shoot, Wikipedia wasn't around. So literally information were just like monumental, a lot of rubbish. So you got, you really have to like search for things, and it's still incomplete in various ways. But people start sharing images. They start sharing their artwork. Blogs start to appear. Forums was a thing in which you participate, you argue, you engage with. And that's where it starts to like take shape, and the internet becomes as a medium, and engagement became digitized as well. We have our portfolios in a CD format, which we have to do creatively. We use various softwares, such as the Adobe Macromedia, now is defunct already, Adobe Flash. So last time we called it Macromedia Flash, then Adobe bought it over and they translated it as Adobe Flash. And we send out our portfolios no longer through mails or just a big hunky portfolio bags, but we send off through mails of our CDs and our portfolios work, and asking for considered for exhibition or for job or prospect or working in the industry of multimedia. Now, literally, that even become a surpassé. I mean, like, nobody use CD to send stuff anymore. They just like, please download from cloud, cloud everything. So everything becomes immaterial. Images now becomes as something that is that you have to retrieve with a single certain lines of text. Then you can have access to such knowledge. But the endangerment to those things, I might have to remind some of these image makers out there, you have to still make it tangible. You still have to retranslate it as an object in a real world. What happens then if one artist passes away or one designer passes away? Who has access to all those terabytes of data when you encrypt it in a username and password, which like maybe very few have access to it, or worse, things get corrupted? So I have half of my life's work gone down in my hard disk. It's just disappeared. So that's a frustrating bit right there. I mean, like during the digital time, everything is saved up and people save back up. But when you have like about 20 over hard disk, your spirit tends to wear off from backing up after a couple of times. So then little that I knew that even hard disk or hardware base have its own lifespan. Somebody told me like, yeah, you got to redo this all over again every 2 or 3 years. They say, oh man, I got to buy new hard disk again just to back up everything. So it becomes as a point, it becomes as a chore. So there's a fine sense of balance right there. Some people prefer, no, you go to cloud. But cloud is as well, there's a physical hard disk somewhere in another area that keeps your data as well. So cloud is not truly immaterial after all. So,
okay. Yeah. That means like I can wondering like, you know, you have actually a lot of hard disk too, especially for all your photographs, pictures, what you have taken. To keep the moment. Okay, Dr. Khairul, before we move forward, let me remind our audience first, we will be having a Q&A session later on. So if any of our audience in the Zoom or Facebook or YouTube, you can ask questions directly on Facebook, YouTube or Zoom. And then we will ask to Dr. Khairul, if you wish to talk with Dr. Khairul, you can let us know. And then during our Q&A session, then Dr. Khairul will answer your questions. So moving forward, Dr. Khairul, why do you think that the traditional arts is actually matters until today?
Traditional art contains the proponent of our identity. Our identity is being built over time. Just like I mentioned before, like when I say the word gambar means picture, it means penukir, penukang. This is the definition of it. Of course, the definition change because the craft making itself, it becomes as a form of identity. We don't get where we are today when we scream and shout that the songket or the batik belongs to Malaysia, Malaya, or and so forth. And we get irated when another country say, no, it belongs to us. And there you go. You have a cultural war right there.
Yeah.
So, and then, yeah, it builds over time. I mean, like, it builds out of a passion of translating things from something that they see in nature and translate it locally within the ability of a person's skill. So, in much sense, the traditional art, the physicality of making art, it becomes as an heirloom. It's an inherited sort of thing, sort of knowledge. So that's why we become much more emotionally attached when you have something that is being given to you. The old photography image of your great-grandparents. And that's pretty much it. What's left is just that image and the stories that is being narrated orally that is being handed down to you. And then later on, when generations later, things are passed on to someone else, that narrative goes missing. The oral narrative goes missing. All that's left is that picture. And it's a picture, and we, the best of an ability of somebody who has no knowledge of the background, they would try to investigate to their best ability on the descriptive elements of the image. So that's where things get, it's a shame. I mean, like knowledge tends to dissipate and it gets not even saturated. There's a lot of missing gaps as well on what we can learn from our past. Of course, we do love to learn a bit more on historical sense, but history must come with a certain valid narratives. That's where I think traditional art comes into play. It's not to supersede digital art, because digital or digital presence has its own foothold. It's an empowerment to the people. So you can't deny that to be out of out of place within the realm of art, because it's certainly a big tool for modern art, or, well, modern contemporary artists.
All right. And Dr. Khairul, a lot of people says that, like, you know, digital art is somehow like a cheating thing. What do you think about that?
Well, it's cheating. It's that's a tragic word right there.
Yeah. I say it's cheating.
It is a shortcut. Certainly. I mean, it's forgiving. There's the undo button. I mean, supposedly. I mean, like I said, traditional art is unforgiving. I mean, once you do the marking onto a surface, let's say a pen onto a paper, that's permanent right there. Even like if you do it with a pencil, if you try to erase it, certain imperfections are going to be there. And then with tradition as well, if you do a certain degree of mistake, even the slightest mistake, you might have to redo all over again. So many hours reinvested again. But however, those reinvestment of hours are the learning of learning of your mistakes.
Yep.
That's where you become a master, because like, you become a master only if you have 1,000 hours worth. Somebody came up with 1,000-hour theory. That means like once you do 1,000 hours of something, you become a master at it. It's a hypothetical. I don't know which the source of it as yet. I recall of hearing about it when I was a student last time. So with digital, you can actually jump and create. And then, but however, it's a cheating. I'm going to drop the word cheating. It's a shortcut.
It's
a shortcut. I'm going to change it. I'm going to not use that, because it's not a nice word to say.
Yeah.
Because you're learning. And then another factor to it is the investment of time. However, the designers, the artists who use digital means still spend hundreds and hundreds of hours. So it's still a practicing spirit that is within it. Digital is just another tool in your toolbox to create things. So to be good at it, you still have to invest time. You still have to come up with your own style. Style, it means like us how a man in a cave that we had discussed early on in our conversation, in which a style is a simplification of the representation of the image in your own way. And people recognize it. People recognize who create what as well within the digital world.
Yep. All right. So, Dr. Khairul, do you think that the digital art actually will take the place of the traditional art?
That's an interesting bit right there. Let's apply per se in terms of economic power. Within digital art, the placement of economic power still cannot compete with the physicality of traditional visual art. Although it's like I had yet still seeing people buy digital prints, digital ones and zero, not prints, digital representation of it in a sense of ownership. Ownership becomes as a transaction of value. So that's where people say, let's say if I buy a piece of Banksy, who's a famous graffiti artist in the UK, and there are a lot of emulation of that work, and authenticity of it still requires a physical being, even though if I buy it online and I have someone print it out and I paste it onto the wall, and people still don't see it as an authentic piece. It's just a cheap knockoff. And then if you have it as a wallpaper, and the value only lasts just as that. It doesn't last any further than that. So it depends on how one puts a value onto it. Digital art per se, it can arrive as a mass emulation of things. It's a knowledge which can be shared from one country to the next within instantaneous reason. So just like us, I'll give one primary example, one of my favorite one. I'm sure you've seen the Mona Lisa.
Yep.
Right?
Yep.
Have you seen the actual painting of it?
I have not seen the actual of it.
Okay, I've managed to get myself a chance, opportunity to go to the Louvre. And it was disappointingly small. It was like, yay, big. It's like barely an A4 size paper. It's like, wow, that's a big hoo-ha for such a small little thing. I mean, you have wonderful paintings from Rubens, from also the peers of Leonardo da Vinci around the museum itself. And people are just like clamoring over it. We've seen so many times of the Mona Lisa in forms or shapes or posters. Digital representation, the memes, that's all over the internet. But however, when you see it live, there's a gust of spirit that goes into like, wow, this is kind of nice. I mean, like now I get to see the real thing as well. I've seen so many digital version of it, but nothing beats experiencing seeing it. I suppose to make it much more a layman, it's like, I'm sure everybody watch football in one way or the other. People have experienced it, watching it from the comfort of the homes, on the couch, very nice environment, air condition, big TV screen and all that. But then again, people still go to the stadium to see a small portion of view of that entire football field. And they just love to experience it. I suppose art per se always goes back towards how one experiences it. So it's how one enjoys it. I believe that's where I think digital and digital comes into place, is to inform the viewer, where else the tradition side of it is to experiencing it.
Yeah. And do you think, like, based on your experience, that which one is actually more popular? Is it the digital art or traditional art?
Popularity, it depends on who is your audience per se. Because one has to ask as well, what is that particular meaning art? Okay, art for art's sake and all that. And for me, it's the accessibility. I do enjoy art that is accessible. And digital art somewhat, not somewhat, allows that. And previously, before anything that is exceptionally difficult was if it's not digital, if it's something that I have to go physically myself, let's say to a certain museum, a certain somewhere in Europe or in the US to actually to experience it, it becomes as an exclusive experience and not accessible. So popularity, in a sense, like I say, when I asked you just now, do you know Leonardo da Vinci's Mona Lisa? You say you know. That's a wonderful thing. At least you know how it looks. So popularity, for me, in a sense, digital brings about that uninformed existence of the art. And then the traditional side is experiencing it and see it in person, and it becomes as a value or experiential value. So can it actually bring, I think the question that probably I try to refine it, express the inner emotion? Does it do the same thing? So traditionalists, if you ask me, I'm part of it, I'm part 50-50, I would say there's no comparison. Contemporary artists would actually disagree and insist computer art is being done by a highly skilled trade and highly skilled designers, which also take years to master. And they still insist that the rules, such as the chiaroscuro or the art of shading, composition, forms and values, are being applied into digital art. Where else the traditional artists would go back and say, no, we did it first, and certainly that the value carries the physicality of it. So both ways. The most important part is who enjoys it most. And for me, the popularity becomes as a stronger point that once the masses are able to access it, that's the most important, access to it, and actually enjoy it as a whole, as one can relate to another person, then I believe that becomes as a stronger valid point rather than a significant few that's able to have access towards it.
All right. Thank you so much, Dr. Khairul, for sharing on your experience. And now I believe our audience is slightly understand more about traditional art and digital art. So we are going to the Q&A session right now. For now, we do have questions from our Facebook. Okay. The question is from a parent whose daughter is actually currently studying 3D animation at UCSI University. Mm-hmm. The parents would like to know if you could give any suggestion about the research topic of the master degree which related with 3D animation.
Okay, 3D animation, that's an interesting bit. It's an exploration within a certain space. 3D, you have a certain engagement. The whole idea of animation, at first when we see 3D animation, we always see it as something more movie-based or theatrical. So one interesting component now is the application of it of today. Now in terms of master's degree or master's program, there is an applied nature of augmented reality, also virtual reality, which is the next wave of big things. Not even next, it's the now. People are applying augmented reality tremendously to assist and to help decision-making. Such as one primary example, I think I recall somewhat not too long ago, IKEA came out like, okay, you can put our furniture with your phone onto your living space. Just apply it and you can see it in so many angles and how whatever ways. So that requires a significant skill set that cannot be reached by the traditional means. So augmented reality brings about this two world into one, which I do enjoy the most when you put in a certain dimension and engagement that doesn't exist in the real world into your phone or your tablet per se. And then it's being applied. A lot of ways it can be also of assistance. One particular last one of the primary project that was being done on the first batch of the master's degree, who had applied 3D. or augmented reality, but it's more on the 2D surface, was the recognition of people who have problems with dyslexia. Now, that's an interesting project in which we came up with this prototype of a book in which emulate how people with visual dyslexia sees the world. They see the word jumps, it becomes shaky, it becomes blurish. Parents and educators see the suffering of the dyslexic through this augmented reality. So it brings about the needed empathy that is actually the whole idea of that project. So some project is not merely about entertaining, but it is also to help and to assist. That's where we become, we are so glad that we are able to execute that project. And it did assist out several of the local schools here to recognize, to empathize as well of people who's having issues with dyslexia or inability to read things proper.
All right. And another question we have here is that, is digital art is a really real art?
Real. Mm. The definition of real, I suppose, is... I think it goes back to what we had discussed earlier, is like how one places value within it. Real art, if we look at the definition of art, let's say art is experiential bit. So if it depends on the eye or the beholder, I would say. If the person who's experiencing it has no tangible or emotional attachment to it, and hence it becomes of no value. This goes in anything. Even on traditional art, if you can't connect with the viewer, it then becomes useless and not real, as one would say. But real art, per se, it needs to communicate. It needs to have a certain attachment to the viewer or to the audience, a certain engagement that it needs to juxtapose itself. And it has this sense of novel or rouse emotion to those that encounter it. Inspiring, aspiring, and some to some extreme degree, even social or politically charged value. Now, it can tread on a sensitive area right there, because we had illustrations or people who have certain engagement politically, who illustrate the political landscape of today, had created a lot of grouses, and certainly they imagine that is a real thing. Is a real imaginative force that actually can change people's perspective. On some degree, it can. But then again, the big question here is just like, how can you get offended by something that's being built from zeros and one? So people can still argue that. I mean, like, you can get offended by a certain degree of things. People get offended by statements, visual statements as well. So whether or not if it's real, yeah, it can be very, very real if you have emotional attachment. That's why some people get really depressed when people criticize or being bullied online. So that's why people put emotional attachment to something that is digital in the first place. So it can be as real as it can get. Yeah, I suppose it is inherently, it can be as real as it can be.
All right. Thank you, Dr. Khairul. Okay, so we know that, like, you know, for traditional art, we have the artists such as Leonardo da Vinci, and then also Rembrandt, Pablo Picasso, Michelangelo. How about the digital art itself? Like, are digital artists can be called as a real artist, like the previous which I mentioned?
Oh, yes. Yes, they can. We have a various multimedia artist that is of today, like studio houses. Some of them work in a team as well. It's not just by a singular artist. Some of them work, even for me, it can be on a commercial value, like art studios or art houses, the animation studios. They produce tremendous amount of work into it. If they are up to the stature of how it's being curated, like let's say Pablo Picasso, and Rembrandt, Renoir, and Leonardo da Vinci, and so forth. Those are in the annex or the canon of fine artists. So in terms on digital artists, they do have its own, but history is still being built as we speak. To those in terms of references per se, just for me, Nam June Paik, who is a Vietnamese artist in the 70s, had this wonderful series of multimedia artwork. Had created a lot of installation work in which, to me, those are being considered as the pinnacle or the beginning of a whole of digital artworks. Even we have a Jerry Yulesman as well in the past, who is a traditional artist who created montages of photographic images in the dark room, which using chemicals, using waters, using enlargers, everything about it is pure analog. And he was dabbling around when I talked to him. He's a very old man now, I think. He was dabbling with, I'm doing Photoshop, which is a horrible sort of job at it. But okay, he's having fun with it. So we have people who's highly skilled, highly able people who are able to bring forward, just like how Pablo Picasso would, just like how Leonardo da Vinci would. And I believe if you give an iPhone to Leonardo da Vinci, I'm sure he's going to have a lot of fun with it. Trust me, he wouldn't toss it away. He's going to make it even much more better versions of whatever his imagination can bring to the table.
That's a really good sharing from you. All right, another question here from our audience. I can see it's, which one is actually easier, digital art or traditional art?
Oh, well, it's returning back to that. Which one is easier? Well, it depends on interest. The key point here is not because I do it because it's easy. I do it because I'm interested in it. I think that's the whole premise of things. It's like some people, if you give them the tool, they have no interest in it. There's no point. Even writing, some people, if you give them a laptop, they can sit down and write a novel within 1 or 2 weeks, a complete transcript of it. For me, it's like if you give me, it takes me ages to create something of that magnitude of a writer's essence. So pretty much it depends on the interest of the person. It becomes easy because you are interested in it. It makes it no easier if your interest isn't embedded in it. This goes well into the areas of music, the areas of literature, performing art, theater works as well, visual art, and every other things that we do. If you give them the tool that they don't have any expended ability to put an investment of time, it doesn't become easy.
Okay. So the next questions I can see from our audience here is that, okay. All right. So we have talked about the difference of the traditional and digital art in here, but what is the advantage and disadvantage in digital art?
Okay. The advantage of digital art, okay, that's an interesting bit right there. The advantage of it is accessible. The tool is being made in various platforms, and then also it is available for all to utilize in every mobile phone, whoever have access to mobile phones, certainly the internet as well, are able to create visuality in terms on creative works, from writing to drawing to even experimental pieces. That's the advantage of it. People can buy an iPad or any sort of tablets and they can actually have a different visuality of it. The advantage of it is the accessibility and the forgiving factor to it as well. You make a mistake, you can still undo it without a cost of a single more of a penny. You don't have to invest in material. Let's say, I made a mistake in this line drawing. Do I have to redo the whole thing again? You can have undo button and restart back, or you can actually decide that's a good mistake and learn from it. It is forgiving in that sense. In terms of disadvantage per se, the disadvantage of it is because of it, be that it is still hardware based, it is still a tangible object. Like I have with here in my hand here is an iPhone 6S. I'm sure half of you guys are laughing. You say, oh my goodness, that's an old dinosaur phone, smartphone. It will become redundant. Technology becomes very, very redundant really fast. It doesn't last too long. I mean, I'm hearing even some of my friends, within 8 months, they already changed a new handphone or a new upgraded version of things. But it depends on what is the requirement that they need. That's the predicament about using technology. It has a certain lifespan to it. And then even more so, some of the companies are control obsessive about the proprietary of the technology. That means that you can't modify your phone excessively. You can't simply just break it apart, change the battery or change the cameras or whatever components within it without voiding the warranty, or even some of it, it just breaks the entire thing, making it useless and rendered like you got to get yourself invested in another phone or in another contraption. The disadvantage of it is certainly it doesn't have the similar durability. And then the next bit right there, that's the hardware. And then the information, just like when you drop your phone in the water, everything, imagine that you haven't backup your phone and you accidentally lost it. Not everything is backed up on the cloud. I know not a whole lot of people subscribe to the yearly cloud thing. I'm sure they live by whatever limitation has been given to them. What if the information is substantial? What if it's suddenly lost within PAP? There you go. Everything's gone. Some people get really depressed out of such a loss of information. And then privacy, security issue as well. Everything's embedded as well. You don't only do your artwork, but you do your banking as well, your economics. Your financial means are all, everything is inside that, your life, your context. So it becomes as a reliant tool. So that's where the danger of it as well. You put all your eggs in a single basket. So if per se, if things are go down south and then you lost everything, then how much are you willing to place your sense of dependency onto such object? So it depends on the evolution of things as well.
Yep. Okay. So the next question is, which requires more skills? Is it digital art or traditional art?
Both. Both requires more skill. Trust me. I mean, like I tried to dabble in some of the newer modern version of even video editing. No, I'm not highly adaptable to learn new steps of software per se. I'm very comfortable with things that I had learned in spirit 20 years ago. What was I learned in the past? What is still can be applied. But when you have new generation of people who's able to do coding and so forth, that's a wonderful thing. I mean, like in terms of going back towards the process, whether things are easier that way or is it harder in that direction, it depends on one's willingness to learn of the technology and the applied software that is within it. So for me, I'm a bit of like old school. I do traditional. I do dabble a bit of digital. Digital is important. It's meant to archive the works. Hopefully, it is accessible even beyond my lifetime. Hopefully, that will be the plan. But certainly, if certain things don't last, then what can one do anyway? I mean, like people will relearn back the knowledge that is being gone. I mean, that is a common thing as well. It's just as much as we worry about people don't leave any traces of physicality behind. People will relearn it back again. They relearn how to recreate the new wheels or something like that. So there you go.
All right, then. Thank you, Dr. Khairul.
Most welcome.
Okay. Now, before we reach to the end, another question is, why does traditional art have more meaning than digital art?
Oh, that's not a fair thing to say. Meaning, just like how I mentioned before, I mean, it depends on the eye or beholder. But however, traditional art is an inherent object, something that is being passed down. something one has to earn. By definition, that's what traditional art, since it exists in physicality, means that object contain a certain monetary value as well. It's being made by certain material. Sometimes people buy because for the sake of a memento as well. So people place in a monetary value onto it. So that is innate of what it's worth, because digital can actually be replicated if it's being allowed to. It can be copied almost, not almost, I think in most cases, 100% of its original. You can copy a file and there is no inherent loss of the value. Let's say the a copy of a book, you can make 1,000 more or 1 billion more of the same thing by copy, pasting, or just multiply it. Where else in traditional, per se, you can't. There is a loss of degradation value as well. I mean, like, you can't actually make a, even if you try to make a photocopy of things, it degrades as a generation goes along. It doesn't apply in the same way. So that's where inherently it's like, does it have more value? Or people say that traditional art, does it place in more value? Yes, I suppose so. I mean, like, in terms of monetary value, yes, it does. I mean, traditional has its place there. Just, it depends on if you value it in that sense. But digital per se, yes, it can be copied. It can be replicated in so many different ways. So hence, what's the point of placing an economic value onto it? Since everybody can enjoy the same wallpaper or enjoy the same music per se. Last time is a big thing where I think in the age of my era as well, Napster, I don't know if you heard of this. I mean, like, people are translating their analog into an MP3 format of music, which was a big no-no. Nowadays, it's a highly encouraged thing. People don't even have to download music anymore. You just download it or stream it. You can enjoy the same thing. It doesn't degrade. The music does not degrade wherever that you listen it to.
All right. Thank you, Dr. Khairul. Last question from our Facebook is, would you agree that the research for practicing traditional art is getting more limited from teachers to the tools itself, and hence the traditional artists are facing more challenges with each passing generation?
Yes, that is correct. Even during my time, traditional artists, the masters, tend to be very secretive lot. If you go and they agree to take you in, for as an understudy, they won't teach you 100%. They teach you probably about 50-60% at best. And the rest, they keep it to themselves, or you learn yourself as you go along. Because a knowledge of that kind of ability and degree carries also economic value. Okay? I mean, like, certain people are able to do this kind of thing because they know they have the particular knowledge, especially jewelry making. Because I had to learn how to make jewelries as well. Oh, during this old photo historical process, yes. I melt silver, I melt gold, I melt platinum.
Oh, yeah, that's really where interesting.
Those are very, very expensive materials. Yeah. To make this old photo historical process, you have to use these noble metals. So there is a component where I have to learn and understand how jewelry making as well. So when I had the opportunity to sit down and discuss with jewelry makers, a lot of their peers, those retired masters or jewelry masters, they say they don't mind sharing the knowledge, but they have to excuse if there is any shortcomings. In which I ask, what do they mean by shortcomings? Well, they age. They are retired. I mean, certain techniques that they used to do are not being applied every day. It's not being practice every day, hence they don't know if the information is being given is something that I already know or I would know on the single observation. So this is where it becomes harder for us to observe and to emulate and to document and to copy. It is not an easy feat, because these people as well, they don't teach you how to immediately something more on the fundamental level. Let's say I'll give one example. Let's say the iPhone. Let's say the iPhone itself, everybody knows where's the on button, right? It's on the side and you just press it for 5 seconds, right? Or 3 to 5 seconds and it fires up. But what if you leave this phone in the next 100 years and no instruction? And people like devil say, oh, turn it on. Just press it and nothing happens. So, and it's like, these people never tell us anything. So there you go. I mean, it's a common knowledge. You press the button, the power button long enough, it fires up or it just shuts down. So if you don't leave enough information, things will get lost and people don't know how to handle it. So that's where I think that's the missing gap that starts to happen throughout traditional artists or giving out their knowledge, the fundamental knowledge. Everybody knows how to do it. Why should I say the same thing over and over again, even though I don't know squat about certain knowledge in jewelry making or certain steps towards making it possible. So that's why I think, is it lost? Yes, it depends on certain area. It's lost left and right. It has to be relearned. It has to be captured in a sense of good documented process as well.
All right, then. Thank you so much, Dr. Khairul. Now we reach to our session to be finished already. So for our audience, if you still have any questions that maybe you are a little bit shy to ask right now, you can always drop us an email. And then also you can visit our website online.ucsiuniversity.edu.my, or you can call directly to UCSI University. If you do have specific questions you would like to ask to Dr. Khairul, you can also send an email to us. And I believe Dr. K wouldn't be mine to answer your questions. So for now, that's it. Thank you so much, Dr. Khairul, for all your sharing session, your experience. It's very interesting. And I believe now our audience know already what is actually the difference between the traditional arts and digital arts. And I hope that our answers can actually bring more knowledge to our audience. So, yep. Let's close this session right now. Thank you so much. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Mary, and the SEC group for having me over for this good, wonderful dialogue and an interesting topic as well.
Yeah.
It's a wonderful session. Thank you so much.
Yeah. Whatever you share is actually very interesting to all of us to know. For your information, our audience is maybe not only like, you know, our existing students, there are parents, there are also our new students that is joining, and also like some students that would like to join UCSI. And I believe some of our staff is also watching us right now. So thank you so much for our audience to be with us in here. Okay, so now that's it. If you have anything, you can always reach us. Thank you so much.
Have a good day, everyone.
Thank you, Dr. Kai.
Thank you so much, everybody. Stay safe as well.
Yep, stay safe.
Okay, you take care now.
Thank you.
Right. Okay, bye.